and think about just really in two parts. One, I'll talk a little bit about in the workforce. I mean, really change and try to impact. And I thought it's stop in between and if you can answer some questions or if there is that one job that we want, and then we can have a big messy discussion. And I'll try to get to it sooner rather than later so that we can have the discussion because we found out to be the richest part of it. So, this is a reference to urban resilience. And, you know, when you think about a city's ability to maintain its essential functions, threatened both by acute events, we call it crisis, and chronic events, we call it stresses. And many people enter the resilience space thinking only about the shocks, the disasters, the earthquakes, hurricanes, tornadoes. But when I think about it, it's also the stressors that can break down and erode a city's ability to function and provide services. And it's the accumulation and the interaction between these. I'm going to argue that the risk profile of New Orleans is not just related to its exposure to hurricanes, to the fact that it's below sea level, that the Gulf is very warm, that big storms get created there, but also that it has had decades of poor transportation, of poverty, of corruption, of economic base and so on, that don't together create the risk profile related to climate change and storms in the world. So, just quickly, we talked a little bit about what the construction earthquakes, flooding, and so on, and the stresses, long term water scarcity, food scarcity, energy deprivation, lack of social cohesion, so where cities have new immigrants that don't trust each other. When you look at something like Arab Spring, where you really had two classes of population, the Arabs, and not clearly felt not represented by the city, and you typically have one fruit vendor in Tunis set himself on fire and the whole region burned. So thinking about what the stresses are important. One other thing, and down here, almost to the bottom of the climate stress is these shifting macroeconomic trends. These new cities overexposed to a particular industry. In our network, for instance, Rotterdam in the Netherlands is nothing if not a huge port. And if you think about in the U.S. context, what's the one city that's almost been wiped off the map? It wasn't because of Robert Greenwood or Northridge or Superstorm Sandy or Hurricane Katrina. The one city is Detroit that was overexposed to a single industry that became uncompetitive. Now, I know Detroit's got a lot of other complexities going on. You look at corruption in the network and you look at predatory suburbs and so on. But it gives you a sense that, even though they don't drive the headlines in the same way, it's actually the stresses, which in many ways are as dangerous as the shocks. So, when we think about resilience, we're thinking about evolutionary resilience. The ability of a city not just to survive a critical stress and bounce back to where it was, but actually, a resiliency is one that can evolve to the new reality. And whether that's climate change or rapid urbanization in the developing world, but cities really are, the 21st century is going to call on cities to evolve in different ways, and that will be one of the hallmarks of resilient cities. So, this chapter is also about world treating urban resilience, and this continues to be an evolving definition. When I arrived at the Rockefeller Foundation in August 2018, this definition was not completely bedded down. We've used it for a few years. It does resonate all over the world, but, again, I say that without transparency, that, it continues to evolve, and the industry to hear your input on it. It's the capacity of individuals, communities, institutions, businesses, and systems within a city to survive, adapt, and grow, no matter what kind of stops and stresses it hits. And this, I would say, this idea of growing has been one that's both been resonant because there are poorer cities as an opportunity to grow. And there are wealthy, cities, small cities, in particular, I'm thinking about Boulder, where this provoked a huge debate about whether growth was important to a domestic or a resilient city, where you have a lot of amounts of growth, something that can make this is not, you know, something that we should strive for. So, we think about resilient systems having seven qualities. Generally, right? So, both the ability to learn and act, you know, and that they are reflective and resourceful, so it's not just good enough to be able to look back and learn, but actually be resourceful enough to change. The number three are about how the sort of assets are treated, that they're robust, that they have limited cascading failure, that they're redundant, that there's enough double checking there, and that they're flexible so that they can adapt to new circumstances. And finally, the lab to inclusive and integrated about how they deal with different pieces of either themselves or neighboring systems. So, both that they're inclusive, and I actually see this, the inclusivity as a key resilience driver as we look at some of the challenges around the world and cities. Whether it's from the migration crisis in Europe or rapidly urbanizing cities in Asia, being inclusive is a key element of the resilient city. And then integrated. And we spend a lot of time, and we'll talk about what we're doing with cities, but getting cities to take apart the sectors and the silos and connect that between transportation and health and economic development and planning. So these are at a very general and high level the qualities that we find in resilient systems. So we ask, what does a resilient city do? What are the elements of that? And for that we have something called the resilient city resilience framework. It's going to be a radical framework, but ultimately it's going to turn into an index. That work is still going on, but it gives the best and most complete example of what we see a resilient cities doing. And basically, resilient cities in this framework breaks into four different dimensions: the personal on the upper right hand side, around personal well being, the economy and society on the lower right hand side. Infrastructure and environment, that's, like I said, out of a place that many, and probably many in this audience, come to resilience in, and finally around leadership and strategy. And I'm going to talk in a little bit more detail about what that means. So, the core, and this is the few slides I'll refer to for those of you in the back, feel free to get your Apple glasses out. The core the drivers of city resilience. And just take it, I'm going to talk through it a little bit in some detail, sector by sector. So, cities that meet basic needs, in other words, cities that provide basic food, water, and energy, housing and energy for their citizens, are more resilient. And we work in a lot of cities where this is by no means a given. That support livelihood and employment through diverse job opportunities. And those that ensure better health services, including public health, including emergency care, long-term care, all of that is a hallmark of a resilient city. Now, I talk about economy and society, and this is now on the sort of forefront, those cities that promote cohesive and engaged communities. I think this is a real differentiator. Cities that are cohesive, where neighbors step on neighbors, where you have strong institutions, those are cities that can weather whatever the shock or the serious stress is. And cities that don't have that are much more prone to coming apart. There's really interesting work, and I don't know if anyone's seen it, by the New York University sociologist Eric Feinberg. On the 1995 Chicago heat wave, and he looked at, so in the 1995 Chicago heat wave killed nearly 800 people, attention, even among poor communities, on how they performed in that heat wave. He found some communities where they were coming apart, that no social institutions, the neighbors didn't know each other, and those communities, people, particularly the elderly and the sick, ended up dropping in their apartments and stayed there for days and weeks until the smell got too bad. There are other communities that have the same income levels, but have strong, robust community institutions, churches, little ministries, local businesses, where people knew each other. And those communities have some of the lowest death rates in the city. So, income level is not the sole and only predictor. Going on to security, health disability, and justice. This is about debt collection, as well as provision of law enforcement, really factor in many resilient cities. And finally, macroeconomic prosperity, cities that have a better macroeconomic situation, not just more resilient. And social environment protects and enhances natural and man-made assets. This is both about the built environment, and we would expect that, and sure everyone here would expect the built environment to be a key factor in a resilient city, but also the natural environment. We see that all over the world. I was just telling a story about Bangalore, a city in southern India. Used to have 1,600 lakes connected by an underground aquifer, and it gets rain 2 months a year, basically. And now, because of rapid expansion, those lakes have been reduced from 1,600 to 300. And that underground aquifer is damaged and destroyed, so now when the rain is gone, it floods, and during the dry season, there are a lot of water. And these given areas are, whether it's deforested hillside and hillsides that lead to landslides, or eroded coastlines that lead to enhanced storm surge and wave action. Community critical services, and allow communication and mobility, this is both about the transportation of people, but also of data, to the asset prospects of a resilient city. And finally, in the upper left-hand corner, this idea of integrating leadership and strategy with strong stakeholders at the table, not just in government, but across the different environmental sectors, civil society, private sector. So I think do that better, and I often argue that the depth, rather than export whatever expertise that they export is governance, but the right governance system where you have, rather than the mayor of government is the president of a local municipal council with the other 32 municipalities in the region, including the area, and starts with the greater of influence. And it really allows that region to implement region-wide solutions that make that city and the region more resilient. So integrating leadership and strategy is absolutely critical. A couple years ago in London. So, opportunity. So it's primarily a transportation intervention, trying to get people from here to there more quickly. And even operating stores in the Berkowitz is being started trying to reduce even the car traffic in the area when that was there. So it works in a couple of different ways. But right, that's not enough. The cost break of infrastructure leads to the health benefits. And the multiple studies that show what those health benefits are. And they reduce CO2 emissions, so they enhance natural and man-made assets as well. And they have a benefit for local retail because they boost foot traffic and actually walking is out of speed, unlike cars where you can, you know, sort of pull over, go into a local shop and so on. So through one intervention, primarily aiming at a transportation intervention, you get health benefits, you get environmental benefits, and you get local economic benefits. And that's the kind of intervention that resilient cities are looking for. Because you know what the next crisis is. Is the next crisis going to demand better transportation? Is it going to demand a healthier population? Is it going to demand, you know, a more robust local economy? I can't remember who I was using this example with earlier. This is also to be used in negative, by the way. So I was talking about in New York, the Fast Fox Expressway, which is built by the legendary, if somewhat controversial, urban planner Robert Moses in the 1940s. So Moses could have argued that if we had this city resilience framework in the 40s, and want to look at it, you could argue that the Fast Fox Expressway is a massive highway that connects Long Island to New Jersey and put right across the Bronx as the main enterprise. Enhanced transportation. Transportation, of course, we know is the hallmark of any resilient city. But if you look at the impacts in some of those other dimensions, one is going to actually it's a negative benefit in terms of resilience. So the Fast Fox suburb, the North Bronx and the South Bronx created by the community of downward mobility in the South Bronx. You see aggregate along that highway at 2 and 2.5 times the city average because of all the traffic. And because you come out this wealthy neighborhood from the west of the city, you start to see crime, spike, and so on. And so, many of New York City's challenges over the ensuing decades, the Bronx is flooding, the rioting apple, the rail effect of the 77 blackout, those are all real resilience challenges. And you can argue that some of them came from emergencies. Well, created the station to build this massive highway here, even though the highway continues to perform as it was designed. And so this is maybe the difference between what a resilient infrastructure and infrastructure that enhances the resilience of the city. The complex just does, it still performs, it survives, you know, Hurricane Sandy and the forest attacks and decades of urban decay, the car box still works. So in that way, it's resilient, but it did not enhance the resilience of the city. And so one of the things we're trying to do is get cities both to assess themselves on this matrix, but also think about the various interventions in terms of what this looks like. So I have a bit of a quick example. Everybody's favorite dark city, Rotterdam, most of the city is below the sea level. Of course, in the 50s, the Dutch had a catastrophic flooding event where nearly 2,000 people died, and the city and the country are worried about the existential threat of climate change. One of the things that they did is they looked for a very innovative solution in certain cases with this neighborhood district. It's a sort of former industrial area. Unlike some of the more upscale neighborhoods in Rotterdam, some of the challenge of flooding. And so they added this water park that both pastors live on, as well as serves as a community meeting place, a basketball and soccer court, and a performance area. And you can see that. So it's designed so it can take water during the floods. Many of the neighbors moved into this water park, but 98% of the time when they're not flooding, they have a much more community-based purpose. And we found that that's the kind of solution that resilient cities can connect. So, that's my little tip on what we're saying is our resilience. I'll stop there for a second and see if there are any questions. Otherwise, I can go on and see what 100 resilient cities is and what we're trying to do. So, any questions? So, you looked at the first swath of bike share went in most wealthier neighborhoods. But I live in a community called the Stigleton, which is, it's certainly transitioned like that, but probably largely poor. And the bike share has recently been in the last, let's say, year gone in there. And what it does is after, really could be revolutionary. And I haven't seen the latest usage charts of who's actually using bike share. But one of the reasons why Bike Sky, which has gorgeous architecture and lots of promise in some ways, has been a difficult place to live in is because it's in somewhat of a transportation desert. So it's not that, it's got one or two subway lines, but it's pretty far from any of the big hubs. But if you think of bike share from my bike share neighborhood to the Atlantic terminus, which is one of the biggest subway hubs in all of New York, it's maybe a 10-minute cycle. It's probably a half an hour, 45 minutes off, and half an hour if you have to get to the train and wait for the train and you take the train down. And that is the kind of thing that can make an hour commute with a half an hour or a 40-minute commute. So I think the answer here is probably that's a fair criticism until now. The new administration has been pretty keen to roll it out in other places, and so they put it into this swath of Brooklyn at the expense of some of the wealthier, other expansions to wealthier neighborhoods. And I can see the usage, so I can't tell you if this is actually really common or not. In terms of our ratings, that all the other 56 stuff indicators is an equal weight. That's partly what the data rose in on the next requirement, even before that was meant to do, is to try to calibrate it in that way. One of the things the designers are thinking about is how you can calibrate it at an individual city or perhaps a region. So some things may be very important in some regions and not so important in others. But the weighting is definitely helpful. And I was about to say about that index, it was still because across 250 variables, you're not going to have golden source data for all of that. So it will still be some mix of both qualitative and quantitative, as well as global golden source and local data. So that's why I I learned about emergency planning in New York in the 90s. And I spent a lot of time focused on preparing the city for hurricanes. And then two times grew into 2000s, right? And so the answer is absolutely, we are never going to know what the most challenge is. But that's why one of the reasons here is we help cities assess themselves while it's dry and weak on this framework. Some cities have great infrastructure, but because of recent immigrants or some family conflict or something like that, they have poor community cohesion. Some cities have really integrated management and strategy, and some do not. And so what this allows them to do is to begin to address that and strengthen the city. And so this is absolutely, you notice how I haven't talked at all very little about the household income lines. I mostly focus on what the capacity is. And so the reason I like this framework is because whether it's a hurricane, terrorism attack, a breakout, asking a motorist to start getting civil unrest, it doesn't matter. This helps cities become stronger, more cohesive, more integrated, and not work more with the interest. You go to PIT, you have to fight because you want to you know, enhanced transportation and mobility. And maybe what BRT is, it's a big BRT, costs $25 million, takes 5 years to build, transports lots of people. And now you can even see the impact of that intervention in this index, because Mexico City at 25 million people is just too big to even, you know, it doesn't, even that big intervention doesn't move the needle. And so that's my one of my big worries in terms of this scale and how that would relate to this index. So I think that's a real concern. Because this decision making tool and not simply ranking the cities. And that has been the line, I would say correctly, or publicly, that the temptations are all to have to be that I'm quite sure once it's a statewide usage. And now, even though there can be concerns about ranking, they also want them, like mayors and competitors. So, I'm not sure, like right now, we're pushing it entirely as a decision making tool. So the reason I like it is because I like this holistic view of, you know, how the different aspects relate to each other. I like, talking about transportation in relation to how economic development and economy, and talking about what the trade-offs are. And so one of the things we're trying to get our students to do, this is for me, it's fully qualitative, not quantitative. To go back and look at each one of their interventions and say, okay, what do I get benefits? What do I get negatives? How am I going to cast this initiative, this intervention, to exploit some of those more of those benefits? You know, if I was going to put parking for water, portable water, into, you know, into the streets in a neighborhood in Berkeley, what now that I want to do this piece, how am I going to also, enhance other aspects of my business? So the part of the roads part is for public health. So by running the fiber up the conduit, I might enhance economic development. If I pave over with permeable surfaces, I might reduce flooding and so on. And so it's been a very interesting framework. At least in its quantitative form, to really think about it holistically. I would also say, by the way, you know, New York started to look at more primary mortality. New York, they started to look at premature mortality, which is the low index number. And thinking about all the different ways in which agencies contribute to reducing premature mortality. Low loss before birth, it's the three-year-old time and balance, it's maternal, it's maternal health, it's housing. You know, so that single number actually was really powerful across the different disciplines to activate agencies around this symbol. So maybe I'll just go on and talk a little bit about what the Water Design Studies is trying to do, and then we can move on. So maybe before I get there, I'll just say, you know, we were the Rockefeller Foundation's big announcement on its centennial, so in 2013. So Rockefeller Foundation founded in 1913. One of the oldest grandest philanthropies, but at this point, by no means the largest. At the time, we were conceived of as a $100 million on the centennial. We were really thought in over the hundreds. And then it's on the road, they're committed to $6 million, and, you know, off to work in these cities. And we're currently in three cities around the world, in New York, in London, and Singapore, and we're opening a Latin American office in Mexico at some point. So, what we're talking about two problems. One is that cities are complex ecosystems, and I think we've started talking about that. And it's hard to get organized around what the key challenges and opportunities are in cities. They don't do a very good job. Well, I think we need to look at when the municipal government's done talking about the entire ecosystem that is a city, various levels of government, various sectors, civil society, the private sector, whatnot. And then the second is that cities, there are a lot of good solutions that are left out, the funding, technical solutions, and so on, but they don't reach cities. Well, because cities too often reinvent the wheel, and they do that at a cost. And so what we're trying to do is to solve for those cities. So we're picking 100 cities around the world that talk about where we're at in that topic. I'm going to work on those four types of support. So funding to hire the chief resilience officer, senior single point of contact that reports generally directly to the mayor, although they stay in a couple of different places and different models around the world. And support to create a resilience strategy basis that looks at what the risks and opportunities are in outlines, what goals, as well as initiatives to meet those goals. San Francisco's strategy incidentally is being released on Monday. We provide them, once they figure out what they need to do, we provide them to an at-scale power, a platform of services and resources they can tap into. Mr. Shah, company on the left, is one of those platform partners. And finally, a membership to a peer-to-peer network. And if you think about it, a senior single point of contact and a leveraged, politically supported strategy to solve the outpost problem and orient people and solutions around what the direction is in organizing the city. And second, this platform of best in class. Technical resources, funding, academics, the best minds on the platform, and many of them appear to be an outlet to help cities get solutions much faster. And we're going to spend, so we're going to spend all $168 million just to fund it. We're not funding any actual initiatives in any sort of. So, there's never the number of cities starting to move around a little bit. I think we're starting at 66 cities. We're actually around 68 cities over these two tranches, and one in 2013, one in 2014. We still have a couple of cities still, so this is why this number is not exactly fixed. There's across 40 countries, 24 languages. We're trying to inspire revolution in a way cities view their risks and opportunities. And so, not just in 100 cities, but in all 10,000 cities around the world. And so, we're starting with lots of diversity. Big cities, small cities, across geographies, dealing with different hazard types, dealing with different capacity levels. So, all cities around the world can see themselves in one of 100, one or more than 100. So, you can see which are cities. We've got the last 16 in North America, across the world. But our last tranche of cities, the tranche that will take us from 66 to 100, will be named May 25th of this year. I would say, when I started this 3 years ago, I wouldn't have thought we've got so many North American cities, but it's really resonating here in the U.S. And we're seeing lots and lots of cities being adopting this. We're seeing the federal government very interested in this and changing the way they support cities. And so I would expect to see another 10 cities or so in the U.S. And we'll see probably more in Asia Pacific, Latin America, and Africa as well. So that's the direction of where we're going. So currently about 51 of the 66 year olds appointed. supporting those CROs, and we've done a bunch of work, whether in strategies and workshops. So we're starting to start with the strategy release on Monday. We've done a bunch of stuff off the platform that I've talked about, including a great engagement by us, helping San Francisco understand its risk to climate change in here, as well as lots of great network sharing. And this sort of gives you a sense of what the life cycle is. It's might be a little too inside baseball. All the way from starting and onboarding and thinking about cities through hiring CROs, through completing strategies, and you can see where the various strategies are. The goal is wave two, so starting in 2015, but really started in 2015. And wave one a year earlier. I would also say, this is meant to be a two and a half year process, a 2 year process or so. But implementation, actually doing the stuff that's in the strategies, that's all generational. We're trying to make economies more diverse and robust. We're trying to fix infrastructure. We're trying to make communities more cohesive, where we know each other better. Is not the work of a year or two or three, that's the year, that's the work of a generation. And so we're thinking about how we can continue to be engaged as partners, providing in resources, helping cities tackle wicked problems, not just this year, next year, but from now until 2030. So maybe some just few thoughts on some of what we're learning. We've seen really great signs of cities institutionalizing the role. So even as cities have ended funding, some of the cities over here, these funding has ended for a lot of these cities, and they're actually they're out the CROs with their own money to supporting it. Our goal is that you wouldn't run a city without a CRO any more than you would without a chief of police, right? And so we're starting to see that happen not just in our cities but in other cities. We're seeing lots of partnering and collaborating between different people and companies in this ecosystem, and that's really inspiring. We also saw Swiss Re, the big reinsurance giant, and Veolia, the French infrastructure company, actually totally rescoping the way they account for system failures in New Orleans. So changing the model by which the tree installs Veolia to provide uninterrupted service in New Orleans is a completely different model. And that allows Veolia to be much more proactive, as opposed to having a facility go down and collecting the reinsurance, getting the facility back online, but actually finding mechanisms to invest in front of that. Governance, as I mentioned, is incredibly, we've seen places where that's stronger, regional-centric governance is places that are more resilient, that are better cities. Whereas places that are more fragmented, or places where it's just all things at the national level, or the state level, and a good example is India, almost all of the power sits at the state level. All the budget sits at the state level, and it's, India, even though it's dense, is the world is 50% urban. India is only 35% urban. It's still a country of villages and farms and so on, so the power is there. And so the cities are built with the resources and attention, but because the state is still thinking about it as a statewide issue, and it's got voters to serve in the villages and in the farms, the cities are neglected. And particularly in Bangalore, which is just a catastrophe, that's one of the other parts of India where the state and the city are much better aligned, Tamil Nadu and Chennai. For instance, where you have a much better sense of that. And we kind of defined that quantifying the resilience dividend much lower in that field. I think it would begin to release capital if we can. If we get better at measuring this, there are a bunch of measurement systems out there. I just talked about the one. But I think having some consolidation around that and at the different scales. So I'm sure a bunch of you are involved in measuring quantifying resilience at a, sort of individual building or system scale. How does that relate to what's called larger neighborhood? How does that relate to the city? I think that those are going to be the really interesting pieces because that will unlock that what we were talking a little bit about. Recognize the knowledge of the developing world. And this will be my last thought, but in terms of qualification, we see the track that we can collect, the guessing the drains, the rains come, flooding happens, digging is borrowed. That is a seasonal, annual pattern all over the developing world. I must be in 25 cities that have that same pattern. But parts of that annual pattern outbreak is there. And it's monetizable. We have to figure out how to extract the money out of reducing that disease. Because we will be able to fund an incredible upgrade to our cities all over the world. It's hard. It's a government issue because take Rio, which has, down there, I thought road analysis by a professor, but the cost of Rio's water are going at the private sector, they're going by the city, they're going at the state, the federal government, and the responsible parties for fixing that are all over the place. And so even though at the bottom line number, you could pay that fixing Rio's water pays back in under 20 years, believe it or not. It's hard to figure out from a government's perspective how to do that when you're not going to pay. And so that's, I think, in some ways, the real challenge of what we're doing. So if we can do that, we can really fix the disease. So, thank you. So, other questions? Research institutions like Stanford that we could then take that research and feed it into cities. Because that was a part of our theory of change we didn't talk a lot about. When I think back over the 3 years, we're usually a step removed from our goal is scale actual research from institutions directly into cities has been not that we haven't done a lot of it. It's hard. We expect that we've seen innovative finance products from someone like SBC or something like that that were informed by research. We've been able to do that, but it usually takes another implementing third party in order to push that in. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
The ones that I've been most directly have been in the urban planning spaces, so LSD Cities has a great program. Our team at Draft, actually, we've done some work there around flooding, and that's been a really interesting place that helps us in India. There's some interdisciplinary schools. What's the host institution in Singapore, like the ETH, Europe, just some of the smart stuff, like the Singapore Management, was funded through 2020, and now we're thinking about it in a way about how we might be sustainable through 2030. And there are a couple of ways. We could go back to Rockefeller and just ask for more money. That would be the easiest, but that is the best. We could go back to the graphic place, and actually this logo you can see.
I'm going to go to the next slide.
steps down for a week or any development, that's a, you know, that's a risk that you don't see any but you do see. I mean, politicians could die. Tomorrow, you know, people are still guaranteeing from their work and make the money. So, I think what we're trying to do is help planners get ahead of that and understand where those breaking points are so that they can begin to. Francisco 2 years ago, we also took Oakland, Berkeley, and Newark. We still put out Newark because I do not do any of this work, really. But the three, Oakland, San Francisco, and Berkeley, we thought would help us begin to look at that reason interaction. Some of them are on the track to the program, so we couldn't take them. That was the problem. We thought we thought about the driven direction, and what has happened is that we thought that students first have to organize themselves around what their own priorities are before you can start to make them important. And so the students have not entirely, but somewhat independently completed their sort of an economy of their work, and we're just now getting ready to tie them together from the rules and the and so, you know, but to use all of that, all we can, you know, most of the things that we would make today resilient or not are regional things. Whether it's transportation or power rural movement and so on. But we were not really able to get there in a meaningful way until we had the cities think about what they intended to do first. And so for now, just getting to that place that I agree with you, which was this floor. But to the point of the question earlier, it's also a very negative question. Is it all good? I'm trying to get the right answer there. It's been interesting.
Thank you.
Yeah.